Hey friends, welcome back to the channel. It's an early start today as I'll be taking you with me on a full day in clinic on both cardiology and pulmonary. Now, clinic doesn't start until 8 a.m., but usually I'll try to use an extra 1 to 2 hours before to try to get some work done. But now it's time to head over to the hospital, and the first part of the day is the cardiology clinic at my nearby Veterans Affairs Hospital. Now, this morning I have 4 patients in person and 1 televisit of my own. So the first thing that I need to do is log in and start reading about the morning's patients to avoid getting behind. Now, our first patient is just about to get checked in, so I'm gonna start pre-writing his note to remain efficient. Boom. Now let's talk about our first case. First, we have a 75-year-old male that has 2 valve replacements of his aortic valve. Now, your aortic valve separates your left ventricle of your heart from the systemic circulation, and it's very common for older patients to develop some level of calcification, and some will develop a narrowing in the opening. Now, when this narrowing reaches a severe level, the patient becomes symptomatic, and so the best form of treatment is to replace the valve. For this gentleman, unfortunately, we have 2 issues that I need to solve. Number one, the type of valve that he has an average lifespan of about just 10 years, and it's starting to show some signs of failure on his ultrasound. And number two, he wasn't taking his medications consistently prior to this visit and is starting to develop signs of heart failure. So the combination of a stenotic valve as well as a weaker heart, no bueno. So we need to start the process of getting him evaluated for a new valve immediately, as well as addressing his weaker heart with newer medications. So as you can expect, this first visit took me a lot longer than I was expecting, so now I'm starting to play catch up. But luckily for me, the next visit is a little bit easier because we have a 68-year-old man who's well known to our clinic, who's had a history of 3 prior heart attacks as well as a bypass procedure, who comes to me today complaining of chest pain. Now, this visit is a little bit easier because he's already had a lot of procedures, and so likely going down the procedure route again to help his chest pain is likely not going to be the best route. And so if I don't have the option of a procedure to fix his chest pain, often I can rely on changes and medications. And some options that I love to address chest pain include beta blockers, calcium channel blockers, and nitrates. And lucky for this guy, we had a few adjustments we can make, and we scheduled him an appointment to see us again in just a few weeks. Now, since this visit was a lot quicker, thankfully I'm all cut up. Now, the rest of the morning is spent calling my 1 televisit as well as seeing some follow-up patients. And keep in mind that each time I see one of these patients, because I'm a resident, I have to present them to our head cardiologist in the clinic to make sure that he agrees with my plan. But thankfully today he's on board with my management decisions, which keeps the clinic moving a little bit quicker, so now I can start getting ready to head over to the pulmonary clinic. But before I left, if you've ever been to a VA hospital, then you know that many of them are notorious for having some delicious popcorn, so I had to make sure that I grabbed some for myself on my way out. Now, for this afternoon, I'll be transitioning from a cardiology to a pulmonary clinic, which personally I'm not that great in, so this will be a good learning experience. So I start the process of making my 20-minute drive to the other nearby hospital to make it in time for clinic. Now, since today is a Friday, the patient load isn't that busy, plus we have a full house of residents like me, pulmonary fellows, as well as attendings who can see the patients. But the first patient that I get assigned is a doozy. First up, we have a 58-year-old female with a history of asthma who presents with a lung nodule on her CT scan. And guys, when I say this looks bad, this looks bad. Now, normally when it comes to a pulmonary nodule that we see on x-ray or CT scan, as long as it's below a certain size, we can typically just follow it on a routine interval of 6 to 12 months. But this one was not only big, measuring more than 1 centimeter in her chest, but also had an irregular shape. And all of this put together was concerning for lung cancer. And the story fit for this patient because unfortunately she also had been a smoker for nearly 40 years of her life. So on this visit, we had to make sure we emergently scheduled her an appointment to have the nodule biopsied. But in the short term, she was also having a lot of shortness of breath from her asthma. And she was describing using her rescue albuterol inhaler 4 to 5 times a day, which is way too much. So for this patient, we started a combination inhaler that she needed to take every day to help limit her rescue inhaler needs. But most importantly, I spent my time on education on things like smoking cessation, as well as the importance that she makes this biopsy. And as soon as I'm leaving her room, I'm a little beat down because of the rough news that I had to break. So I'm definitely starting to feel the fatigue, but I have one more interesting patient I have to see before I call it a day. So last up, we have an 82-year-old female who's referred to the pulmonary clinic for complaints of hemoptysis, or coughing up blood. Now, this patient came to us with a CT scan of her chest, and she had some very interesting findings at the top of her lungs, which were classic for an old tuberculosis infection. And sure enough, when I took a deeper history, the patient admitted to having TB several years ago when she lived in Mexico. And after further lab workup, it looked like she didn't actually have another active TB infection, but more likely a sequela from the damage that the last infection had done. So we made sure to put her on the right regimen to keep her airways and secretions clear to minimize the hemoptysis in the future. And thankfully, in between the time that she was referred and when we actually saw her in the clinic, she was already starting to feel better. But with that patient have been seen and my notes now all signed, overall a great day with some interesting, classic, as well as unique cases. And I hope you guys enjoyed following me throughout my day, and hopefully you learned a thing or two. As for me, I'm planning on going home, putting my feet up, and relaxing for the rest of the day. Oh, and also starting to picture the next time I can have more of that popcorn. But until then, guys, guys. Thank you so much for watching. On your way out, make sure you hit that like button if you enjoyed this video and also support the channel. And if you haven't done so, consider hitting that subscribe button to get more videos like this in the future. But as always, guys, thank you for joining me on my journey. Hopefully I was a little help to you guys on yours, and I'll see you guys in the next one.